Welcome. Welcome to this webinar. This webinar about the five lessons I learned from business constellations. And well, I will introduce myself a little bit. And I am also interested in who you are and where you're from. So well, let's start with that, actually. So please, in the chat, can you say where you're from? What country, city? And then I also have a little poll for you, but let's see in the chat where you're from so we can see what countries we have connected here. Bulgaria, Slovenia, Romania, a lot of Eastern Europe, I know that. For some reason, I'm attracted to Eastern Europe, very interesting. Ukraine, great. Romania as well, cool. Yeah, of course, Christina is here. Yeah, cool. Other people from other countries, other places. Wiesbaden, Germany, very good. Welcome, Hungary. Cool, cool. It's interesting. There's something in me that really likes to connect with people from all over the world. So for me, this is really exciting. Welcome. Welcome to this webinar. Also to the people that are watching later, because I got a message from some people that I cannot make it live. And there will be a recording also for you if you're watching live, but also for the people that couldn't watch live. So let me explain a little bit about myself. So where am I from? That's an interesting question always. The Netherlands, which is this wonderful country here. And in the Netherlands, I live in Deventer, which is a little bit to the east. Well, the people in Amsterdam say we live in Germany, but it is still an hour from the German border. And this is what it looks like at night. So this is one way of explaining where I'm from, but from more business constellation or from a constellation point of view, it's interesting to see where I'm from. I can give a different answer to that. Because I was born in 1970. And where do I come from my father and my mother? So that's, yeah, my family. I also have a brother. Should have put him in there. And then I went abroad. After my high school, I went to Texas. Fort Worth, and that also already shaped my international experience and my ambition to do things internationally. Then I went to the University of Groningen. I studied management and organization, and then I went to work at IBM, Syntense, which is a consultancy firm for small and medium enterprises. And then in 2007, I started my own company, first only in Dutch. And then in 2016, oh, here you go. 2016, I started Business Intuition. And I got connected with SOL, the Society for Organizational Learning. And it started in Bulgaria. So it's great to see people from Bulgaria here and other Eastern European countries. But I also have a private life. I was married. I am still married, actually, to Marianne, and I have two daughters who are now 17 and 15. And then to say where am I from a more point of from the business constellations, I was taught by Nienke Binkhorst, who is at the bottom left, and also did workshops and trainings and at Jan Jacob Stam, who is the guy on the left, and Hilke Bonema, who is the guy on the right. And they were both students from Bert Hellinger, who's at the top. And Bert Hellinger is the one who founded the Constellations in, I think it was 1989 or something like that. So that's my education, and it's also my background where I came from. But I've been to many different workshops and trainings to get a broad view of Constellations. And then the interesting thing is that with all this background, I'm also connected to the church, to Christianity, because Bert Hellinger was a Christian. He was a priest, actually, but he was also connected to the Zulu and to psychology. And Nienke Binkhorst is more connected to shamanism and also to energetic work and more spiritual work. And Hilke Bonema and also Nienke and Jan Jacob are more connected with the business world on the right. So that's also in my background. So if you ask where do I come from, well, this is also part of it. And what I'm interested in is how familiar you are with business constellations or with constellations in general. So please, you will see at the bottom of the screen, you will see a little questionnaire. And there you can answer the questions or the question, how familiar are you with business constellations or with constellations? Okay, so just fill it in. I'll show myself again. I like that. You'll see me looking to the right for me. I don't know, maybe left for you. No, this is my first encounter, 17%. I've experienced one. So that's, I've experienced one. I have more than one, very familiar. Well, actually, it's quite divided. People very familiar and people a little bit familiar. So yeah, well, I'll explain, and if sometimes it will be a repetition and sometimes it will be fairly new for you. So let's also, why do I do this? Because my mission is to align businesses with the needs of people and the planet and making profit as a result, and not the other way around. And I found that business constellations and constellations in general, or actually business intuition, because that's my company, help you to do this by using intuition and intuitive methods. And one of the intuitive methods is business constellations. And I like working from a consciousness of unity and wholeness instead of division, and we're all separate and we need to make profit and we need to compete. And well, that's not the way I look at doing business. Well, the thing with business constellations and constellations, it is what they call a systemic approach. Don't mix it up with systematic, because that's completely different. Systemic is taken from the German, actually. Systemisch, I think it's called. And it is looking at the whole of a system, not looking at the parts, but looking from the whole perspective. And it starts when you were born. And the thing is that Bert Hellinger, he introduced constellations as family constellations. And many people are familiar with that. And family constellations are a therapeutical method to solve problems you have in your personal life. And also there's this systemic approach, which says that as soon as you're born, you're part of a family. At least you have a mom and you have a dad. And as soon as you're born into this system, because this is what we call a system, it's a part getting together, and they form a system which has different characteristics than the individuals together. A good example that my teacher Jan Jacob Stam says is, like, if you have a class with all students that are okay, there some are very good, some are not very good, but and some are very kind, but as a group they can behave as a monster. And so that the group energy is something different than all the parts together. And it's the same with the family, and the family is even larger than this. So as soon as you're born, you're part already of all of this whole system, and it goes seven generations back. So it's quite an energy and a system you're coming into. And then when you go to school, there's me again with the whole family system. You're in school with different kids, and they all have these backgrounds. And then you go to work to a company. And again, all these people have these backgrounds with all kinds of systems. So it can already be interesting to ask somebody, what systems are you part of? And systems, that's like family, of course, but it's also the soccer club, or it's also the Well, I'm part of the constellation system, or maybe the management consultant system. So there are so many systems, the church or after school activities, different schools, alumni. So you're part of many, many systems. And then you come in this company, and the interesting thing is, in a company, another system is created. So there's, again, something that is larger than all the individuals. And I'll come to that later, but a lot of problems are not caused by the individuals or by a system, like not by the hierarchy or something. It's more this larger system energy, or what you call it, that is influencing what we see in daily life. Because the interesting thing is, a company also has a history, and this history has a lot of influence on today. And we might not notice that, or we might notice it a lot, but sometimes we might not notice it. And there are things happening today, and problems we see in the daily business might occur because something happened in the history. So you see already how complex this is getting, because then we have departments. So these two individuals make up a department, or maybe 20 people or 200 people. And there are more departments. So that's also a system on its own. And how the departments interact is something between different systems. And then we talk about a client. And as soon as the client comes in, there's this, you see that the darker green background, that's another system is created between you and your company and the client. And then we have a product or service, and we have money coming back, and we have the effect of the product or service on the world. And that's also, as soon as you start doing business with a company, with clients, you create a lot of systems. And the thing is, we're not aware of this. A lot of this is happening unconsciously or subconsciously, I rather like to say. But if you have repeating problems, or if you have problems that you really cannot get into, you don't know, your rational mind cannot help you, then you might want to look into these systemic causes of problems. Well, and one way of doing this is with constellations. And the interesting thing is that Bert Hellinger first started doing constellations. And then after having done like thousands of constellations, he found these patterns and these laws or forces that are active in systems. So it's one of the few theories that was created by doing a method, and not a theory that creates a method. That's what I always also like about it. And the interesting thing is also, let me show myself again. Interesting thing is also that it's a free tool. Everybody can use it. There's no certification. There's no quality control, which, actually interesting for the Germans, because they really like quality control. But Bert Hellinger decided that this is something that everybody can use. And that's why you'll have a lot of different types of constellations and a lot of different people doing it. And for me, it's very good to have it this way, because I believe that everybody, if they really follow their intuition or really connected, they attract their own clients that will benefit from their approach. So everybody gets their own approach, and we get a whole rich world of constellations and facilitators. So how does a constellation work? Well, actually, it has these steps. In the training, I always start, this is how a constellation works. And now you can do it. So you do the interview. In an interview, you try to find out, okay, what are the elements that are at work here? What do we have to look at? What system do we look at? And you have a look at the question. But the problem is that as coaches and consultants, we're used to consulting and coaching. So we really want to know everything. But actually, you're just looking for facts and not why things are happening or interpretation. It's just facts. And then you choose the elements. What elements are you going to work with? And for companies, that could be elements like the company, the client, a market approach, or maybe departments, or you can also look at positions, like the director, and not the person, the director, but the function director. And you can have a look at team leader or HR. So there are different, and that's interesting. And what I like about business constellations more than family constellations, there are so many different elements you can use and so many different ways you can look at companies. And with family constellations, you have father, mother, brother, sister, maybe uncles, maybe some grandparents. So it's much in that way, it is easier to do family constellations. On the other hand, family constellations are very much more therapeutical, and that requires something else from the facilitator. So after you've chosen the elements, you place the elements in the room. And now, well, here you see a picture of people that were representing, well, actually, they were representing elements in, I think this was Braga, based on a question for the city of Braga. And then all you do actually in the beginning is just observing what is shown. What is happening here? You don't have to explain. You don't have to understand. It's just observing. And that's, again, something we as coaches and trainers and consultants and managers are not used to. We want to fix things. We want to change it. No, we just have a look. And then you follow the flow of the field. So what will happen? And that's, well, yeah, a little bit of magic. But they've done research into this, and it works. And they cannot explain why it works. That's interesting, because somebody who is representing an element, and it's easier to look at family systems for this, is if somebody represents your father, he might just act as your father, talk like your father, have the same gestures as your father. And it's so interesting how this can happen. I've been a representative myself many, many, many times. And as soon as you're put into the constellation, something changes. You feel things, you sense things, you think things that, well, where do they come from? And you want to move. And this is the magical part of constellations, which is quite strong and powerful. And at the same time, it's, for some people, it's also a little awkward and uncomprehendable. And well, if everybody moves, and sometimes I ask people, what do you sense at this, look, how do you feel at this place? You get a feeling of what is happening here, what is the tensions, where, what is really creating the problem. And then there are different systemic interventions you can do to free up some energy, to clear things, to get things in motion. And the interesting thing is that as soon as you do that in a constellation, the real world will change as well. I've done it myself with family constellation, that something changed in the constellation and my life was different. I've done it with businesses. I've done it actually with a house. Somebody wanted to sell her house and she did a constellation with me. And we found out that she was mixing up the house with her baby. She was pregnant. And well, it's difficult to let go of a baby, but it's not difficult to let go of a house. But there was some confusion there in this field. So she was not conscious of that, but due to the constellation, she became conscious, and she already changed in the constellation. She let go of the house and she said, okay, it's not my baby. And a week later, she sold the house. So things really change. And the last part is finishing up. So it's more like, okay, so what, it's also releasing the people from their roles. It is talking to the question owner. So what is, do you need anything else? And in a business environment, more than in a family environment, sometimes you also talk about the constellation. What have we seen? What lessons can we learn? How did we learn? So what are our next steps? So that's basically what a constellation is like. If there are any questions, feel free to put them in the chat and I'll have a look at them every now and then and answer them, because then that way you can also interact with me. So that's the core of the constellations, is putting yeah, make it visible, tangible, spatial by putting people there. But I see, yeah, that's two slides further down. I'll talk more about there are more different ways of doing a constellation. So if there are no questions, we continue. Because a little bit about how they work, but then more, yeah. I always see it like a magnetic field. And you see these files of iron, they show you the field. And if they're not on the paper, then it's like, huh, why is this happening? Why is this piece of metal moving? Why is it going from one side to the other side? We don't know. This is strange. And then as soon as you put the files on it, the iron, oh, there's this magnetic field. Now we see it. And it's the same with constellations. There's this systemic field. And by putting people or objects in a place representing somebody or something, we get a view of the field. And well, you can, 0-point field is something that's connected to it. You have the quantum physics that are connected to it. Linda McTaggart has some information, not specifically about constellation, but they give you a view into a world that is, yeah, that might explain how constellations work. I see a question. Hi, have you done it yourself to act all the roles? That's a Taja, yes. I'll explain that a little bit later. Because here is, what can you use constellations for? So there are many areas like family constellations, and it doesn't mean that you have to do it with your family, because they're just total strangers representing your family. You can do with an organizational questions, career questions, illness, health questions, relationship questions, teams, marketing questions, strategy questions. Well, and you can be as creative as you want, past lives, whatever you want. Then there are many types of constellations. You can work with a group of people. That's the traditional one. You have a workshop and somebody has a question, and when you place other people of the other participants as representatives for the different elements. But you can also do a tabletop constellation one-on-one. You see that on the picture. This was a training I gave in Paris 2 years ago, I think. And then you use little gems or little dolls or little whatever objects to represent the different elements. But then, and that was a good question, Tarja, is that then as a facilitator, you have to represent all the different elements because you don't have other people to do that. And the same with floor markers. You can use markers on the floor. We're going to do that in the exercise. And then as a facilitator, you can, there are different ways, and that's what you learn in the training. If you want to learn more, there are different ways of facilitating. But one is that you step on the different pieces of paper representing the different elements, the different roles. And yeah, that requires that you are able to step in, step out, step in, step out. You become a representative, you become a facilitator again, representative of something else and a facilitator again. And yeah, it might look like a hard work, but as soon as you use your intuition, it's not hard work anymore. You can even do it in visualization. So you can visualize your family or your organization or your company with clients and see what is happening there. And you can also do it by drawing, and probably many more. If you're creative, you can think of many more. And then there are different ways of facilitating. And that has been evolving during the years as well. Bert Hellinger was very directive in the beginning. He said, okay, now the father and mother need to be next to each other. And now the child needs to kneel. And later on, it's more an intuitive approach, which is what I often say is, okay, is there anybody who wants to move? Follow your inner movement. And then, well, in silence, people move around. There are even constellations in complete silence. There are also fixed interventions, like, okay, if you want to do honor the parents, they are mostly from family constellations, honor the parents, and then you need to bow and you need to say this and say that. Yeah, which is good, but it's also very fixed. there are fixed formats. There's this, what they call, for example, tetralemma, which is a way of working with dilemmas. If you think I have choice one and choice two, one, I have to do the one or the other, then this constellation will really get you new insights. So there are different ways of facilitating constellations. And it all depends on what you want, what your client wants, what you feel comfortable with. So that's also what I like doing in my trainings, is have you find out what do you like, what do you feel comfortable with, and find your own way of doing it. Don't copy mine, because well, that is mine. That's the way I do it. So that's a little bit about the constellations. How do they work? What can you use them for? If there are any questions about that, let me know. Yes, and well, you hear maybe already in the way I talk about it, is that constellations have really helped me to get to the core of problems and not talk about a lot of things and analyze and take a long time to find out what is really happening. Constellations, well, we did it, I think, last week. We had a group of 40 people, but we went into five groups of eight, and we had 1 hour. And there was a big problem, and we had to look at it from different angles. And I facilitated a group to do a constellation, to look more from a systemic point of view. And in 1 hour, actually 45 minutes, we had so many insights for the company of what to do. I think normally that would take like 12 interviews, maybe 4 or 6 months of analyzing, and then you didn't even get to the core. So it is very fast, and I'm a little bit lazy, or I like to be lazy. So I like things to be, easy is not a good word, but it needs to be in flow, and yeah, I like to go to the root of the cause. So I see that there is a question. Do you do it for yourself? Yeah, that's a good question. I do it sometimes, and you can do it for yourself. The only thing is that, yeah, you have your blind spots. And if you facilitate yourself, then you will not find your blind spots. So it will help until a certain degree. All right. So then we come to the lessons. And lesson one. In organizations, or in systems, but also in organizations, there are three leading forces. Some call them laws, some call them life-giving forces, but they are ways, well, actually, if something is wrong with these forces, then you will find problems at the surface. I always talk about the surface and beneath the surface. And this is what's happening in the subconscious below the surface. And by actually only using these three, you can already find a lot of solutions that you wouldn't find before. So one is place. And that is a force, or actually a law, that everything in a system needs to have its place. And everything has its place. So, well, in a family, there's all the family members, but sometimes we have this uncle or aunt or somebody who did something wrong or didn't fit in or who didn't follow the culture of the family. I think my grandparents, they were quite Christian. They were, and I have one, or my father has a nephew who is a pimp. He has a hooker company, and wow, that didn't fit in our family. So he was like the black sheep. Fortunately, he was not really excluded, but most of the time people like that get excluded, or people that were wrong in the war, whatever wrong and right might be, because we now think things are wrong, and they are excluded. And then the system will do something to include those people again. But that works subconsciously. So it might be that the grandson of somebody who has been excluded will have the same behavior or maybe the same characteristics of this this family member, and he will have the same problems. And as long as he doesn't find out that this is related to somebody who has been excluded in the family, he might not solve that problem. In organizations, it's the same. In organizations, you might also have, for example, a manager who did something very wrong, who betrayed the company or stole a lot of money, and he was fired and nobody never talked about him anymore. Like this page was ripped from the history of the company. But you cannot rip a page from the history of the company. You can do it, but the larger system will always include people, but not by saying, sending you an email, we have excluded this guy, please include him again. No, sometimes using some of the other members to show this. An interesting thing about place is that everything has its rightful place. So if you have a company or your company, it has a rightful place in the market. But you have to find your place. What is your place? What is your unique place in the market as a company, or if you have a small company, you yourself in the company. So there will be no competition if you have that, find that place, because there will be customers, consumers, or clients that are connected to that place. But what I see most of the time is that people try to imitate somebody else. They would try to copy some successful people. But you need to find your own place. So that's very important. Well, and the same goes for your inner world, because you are also a system. So you have all these voices inside your head. You don't have to be crazy for that. People have that. And by not accepting one or two of the voices, you're excluding them, and then your system subconsciously will include them. And yeah, you will have problems, maybe physical problems, mental problems. And in constellations, I quite often find out that this has to do with excluding parts of yourself. So that's the force of place or inclusion. And then there is this force of exchange. And that's, I like this picture, because it's like giving and taking. And as soon as you give, you take. And as soon as you take, you give. And this needs to be balanced within the system, and also between the system and other system and the outside. And it's always not really in balance, because you give and then later on you receive. And that's also what is creating energy and movement in systems. But in the end, it should be balanced, that you feel, you sense that, okay, the giving and taking is balanced enough. And as soon as that is not balanced, then there will be something, the larger consciousness, the larger system will create something to say, hey, it's not in balance, it's not in balance. And that is what we see as problems in organizations or in our lives. But actually, it's not a problem. It's a solution of the system by saying, okay, I need to show that there's something wrong with exchange. And that's what I do with creating this problem. So this is interesting for companies. Well, let's start with families. Exchange with families is a little different, because as a parent or as a child, you have received life from your parents. And as a parent, you have given life. And that's so much that you cannot never give that back as a parent, as a child. So that's something that you receive, and you don't have to balance it, because that's impossible. The thing you do, you pass on life, or sometimes if you don't have children, you pass it on by doing good in the world, or by helping others, or so that's the only thing when exchange doesn't really have to be balanced, the giving and taking. And in organizations, a lot is connected with money, but money is not the only way of keeping the balance of exchange balanced. It's also attention, love, rewards, recognition. And with clients, it's always good to realize that lowering your prices will give them a debt. They will get a debt if they don't pay enough for what they get. Then there are they will feel one way or the other that they owe you something. They want to pay you something back. And sometimes they might even express that by saying, oh, I don't like the product and I don't want to buy it from you anymore. But underneath the water, it's more like, okay, there's no balance. So it's interesting to look at problems from the exchange point of view. And finally, we have the time or order principle or force, and which says that there's always a natural order in systems. And families is very easy. There's this generation, and you have your child and you have a parent, grandparents, great grandparents. And if you, for example, take over the role as from your parent and you start taking care of your sister or you start taking care of your dad, then well, there's something wrong with the order, and it's going to influence the system, and there are going to be problems because of that. Sometimes you have to do it because, well, yeah, as a child, you really feel what is wrong in the system, and you step in wherever is whatever is needed. But later on, you need to find out, oh, okay, that's what I've been doing, because you will be repeating these patterns. Then in work life, you will start helping your boss while it's not your task to do so. So it requires reflection, looking from this systemic point of view. And then there is age. Age is also a very easy order. There are people that were born before you and after you. But in companies, we have many, many orders. We have seniority. So how long have you been with a company? How long have you been in this business? How much knowledge do you have? We also have age, but we also have hierarchy. And well, we can tell from many, many, many constellations that hierarchy is not a very important order in companies. There are other orders that are more important and more influential than hierarchy. So that's interesting if you work with companies. So that's lesson one, is that these forces are very important in companies and can really help you if you look from with these glasses to a company. Lesson two, there are repeating patterns. I already talked a little bit about it. If you have this pattern in your system that you tend to take care of your parents, then you might in the company tend to take care of or take the role of your supervisor, of your boss. But there are other patterns that could be repeating. And it's very interesting if you work with a company as a manager or maybe as a consultant, is to have an eye for this. Because, well, for example, I've been working for the police. And security is one of the things that they provide for the world. There's not enough security, and they come and they provide security. So that's the problem of the client. So within the client in this case is society, there's a problem of the pattern of insecurity. But what I saw is that within the company, within the police, there was also insecurity. And that's interesting because it's repeating actually what it is solving in the world. And it's also probably between between the police and the citizens that there is some issues with security and safety. And it's also between me and the company. Well, back then I really didn't look at it that way. I didn't, there was some kind of insecurity inside of me related to doing business with them. And it's also in the families of the employees. There might be a security issue in their families. So as soon as you have a look at the companies, you can just ask them, what is the main thing you do in the world? What is the value you are creating for your customer? And you might find a pattern and just look at that pattern inside the company, between the company and the clients, between the company and the suppliers, but within the families, within the company. So it's a very interesting way of looking at companies. The only thing is that you need to really be aware of what is the real pattern and how can I describe it. So it requires some some practice. And of course, as with everything, is that you need to check it, because you can like be this voodoo man and say, oh, I know what's happening here, but you need to check it. But often it works. I work for this Syntense. It's an innovation oriented company, creating or helping helping companies to innovate. And well, to be honest, changes in that company were very difficult to do. So innovation and change was very difficult. And I have to agree that in my personal life, I don't really like to change. And in my family, there's also this pattern of people working for the government and doing the same job for a long time. So it's interesting to see how things are repeating and how that can help you to find solutions also for problems. So then we have lesson three. And lesson three is that there is this initial purpose. As soon as a company is founded, there is this spark. The French have raison d'être, reason of being, the purpose. And it's very important to stay connected to this. It should be respected, and it will guide everything consciously or subconsciously. So in the company, there is this there's this larger force, and we'll come to that later, because it's ignited actually by when you found the company, or when the founders found the company. And it's interesting to find out with each other, with the company, what was it that, why were we founded? Why, what is the raison d'être of our company? And is it still valid? It can be valid in a different way, of course. So like we have this supermarket here, Albert Heijn, which was founded to bring special products from all over the world for regular normal prices to the normal people. And they still do that. They still bring in different products from different parts of the world. But they are different products than 50 years ago, but they're still doing this. And sometimes the purpose is fulfilled, and then you need to be strong and brave enough to say, okay, it's time to end the company and maybe find a new company, or maybe find a new raison d'être, a new reason of being. But sometimes it's just, it's not done in the business world to say, okay, we're finished and we just pull the plug and it's done. But it might be very helpful to do that every now and then. There are some, and it's interesting, you can do that with a constellation, find out how much potential is there left in this company. And well, if there's no potential left, why not just say, okay, we've done it. Be very proud of what you've done, because there was a reason why this company was started and now it's done. And there's this story about this entrepreneur who started her own company. And I'll show myself again. And what happened is that it was not really going well. There were no clients and the money was not flowing. And then this coach asked her, why did you found your company? What was the reason? Well, I wanted to be free. I wanted to enjoy life. Or for most of all, she wanted to be free. Are you free? Yes. So then your company can stop, because that was the reason of your company, the purpose. She goes, whoa, okay. And at that moment, you don't have to really stop this company and start a new one, but you can say, okay, so that was the first purpose, but there was maybe a purpose behind it, a larger purpose, and find that purpose. And then you can start. Yeah, it's also about giving meaning to your business again. So it's an interesting way to look at companies. Have they reached their purpose already? Lesson four. You have to see organizations as an organism. And well, if I read a lot of literature these days, it's going into these directions, that it's not a machine. Organizations are not machines. Please don't look at them as machines. And we still do. We want to fix things. We have input and output. We are all parts. And if the parts work together, we produce good things. And we have human capital. those are all wrong metaphors. We need to look at them as an organism. And in organisms, you cannot manage an organism. And so you cannot manage an organization. And I know this is really blunt to say this, but it's, you cannot manage an organization. Managers are only trying to grab on to what they can control and that what the, in general, and what they, how they can control and how to can, how they can predict things. But, and that's also interesting if you look at Reinventing Organizations by Frederick Laloux. He also says that evolutionary purpose, he calls it, evolutionary purpose is about that there is this larger, greater consciousness that is guiding an organization, that an organization is a system. And this system, this consciousness has a purpose and is going somewhere. And what would happen if all the managers and all the people would go, let go of resistance and tune into this larger consciousness and then see, oh, where does it want to take us? Instead of where do we want to take it? Where does it want to take us? And what would happen then? Then you would create flow. And if you read the Reinventing Organizations, that is when you get very successful with your business. And in from a systemic point of view, from the Constellations, they have found that there's what they call system consciousness. And system consciousness, I've already talked about it, will always try to fill the gaps of existence. What Jan Jacob Stam calls it, gaps of existence, which means that if somebody is excluded, he will say, no, this guy exists as well, or this department exists, or this country exists as well. It's interesting, for example, with Israel and Palestine, there's a larger system saying, okay, there's a gap of existence because we exclude something. And it will also work with the depth gaps. If there's this exchange of giving and taking and it's not balanced, then there will be a depth. And this larger consciousness will almost hire people in the system to do things to balance this out again. But it will never really work until we see the gaps of existence and the depth gaps, and we will change things. So for me, this was also a very important lesson. And even with my own company, is that I thought that I can do, I want to go that way, but then it didn't really work. And when I didn't do anything with business oriented anymore. I left the business and I said, okay, I'm going to work with coaches, no matter what they want to do. I'm going to work with coaches, teach them how to coach and how to improve their lives, or help others improve their lives. But I left out the business part, and that's very important for me and for my company. So as soon as I came back and included business, business oriented intuition into my company, it started flowing again. So it's just interesting to explore what would happen if you look at organizations as organisms. And if you use that metaphor, so how can we create a context or like an ecosystem in which this organization can flourish? What does it need to eat, and how can it also renew itself? Because an organism is not something that is fixed. No, it's continuously moving. There are things, parts dying, and there are parts growing, other parts dying, other parts growing. So how can we look at businesses like that? That sometimes, well, how can we just let go of something and to create something else? And then the fifth lesson is that there's no good nor bad, which I know is a little blunt again, but that's what I like. But what I've seen in Constellations is that things that might seem bad after a constellation, I thought, hey, this is interesting. It's actually good nor bad. It's just happening. So it's about acknowledging what is. Actually, that's a book Bert Hellinger wrote. Acknowledging what is, just saying yes. Yeah, when I'm saying, it can be almost an exercise you can do is when you have problems and you see things in a company and you say, yes, only say yes, this is what it is. No judgment. And then connect with deeper layers. What is happening here? Curious, exploring, experimenting, not like, okay, I know the answer. We go from A to B, step 1 to 6. It's not a machine. You have to tap into this energy of the company and let go of your ego. I mean, sometimes you have to do things that are, well, seem bad for you, but they, in the end, they might be good for you. But your ego is also very scared of new things, and your ego has been hurt before. And so it's always also personal development is also part of growing business and helping businesses to grow. And also facilitating constellations for me has been very, very helpful in following my intuition, not wanting to fix anything, just go with the flow, embrace the not knowing, and just see wherever it takes you. So that's what I also like about constellations is that every time I facilitate a constellation, every time it's a practice in letting go, in using my intuition, and in acknowledging what is and no judgment. So it's probably something in my system which is repeating in my work. And yeah, I like that. So if there are questions, please let me know in the chat. And then we'll go to the exercise, because we're going to do a real constellation. We have 7 more minutes, which is not a lot, but I hope that people have some little bit more time. 2 questions. Before starting a constellation, are the participants informed on the objective or problem to be solved? Well, the interesting thing about your question is that something needs to be solved, but okay. It might not be solved. It might be that you just get an insight and... most of the time they are informed, but they don't have to be informed. You can just fly in people not knowing anything and ask them, do you want to represent element A? And that only the question owner knows who is A and who is B. And I've done both types of constellations, and what I call blind constellations are very interesting. And for the representatives, it's very exciting and very... very strange also that they can sense all kinds of things. For the people watching, it's very difficult because they don't know who is who, and they don't know who is representing what and what is happening. So it has different, there we are. But you can do it that way. Yeah. Our solutions to problems found by the end of the constellation of the work is done by the person afterwards. Oh, that's a good question. The question is, are solutions to problems found by the end of the constellations, or the work is done by the participants afterwards? And it's both. Sometimes it's very clear after the constellation, wow, this is the problem, and this is actually the problem. So this was the solution, and now this is the real problem. And actually in the constellation, often you free the energy and know what steps you need to take. But sometimes it's a little bit more subconscious. And then 2-3 weeks later, people get an insight, or they go, whoa, this is interesting. Or they have this meeting and they say, looking back at the constellation and the knowledge of the past 2 weeks, this is what we saw then when X and Y happened. So a lot of the times it happens right in the constellation, but a lot of times, or sometimes it takes some time. And it, I know for a constellation I've done, I think 10 to 15 years ago, it took me 3 to 5 years before I found out what really happened there. So sometimes it takes time. Okay, we're going to do the exercise. You need a piece of paper. You write on one piece of paper, me, your name, I, yo, whatever it is in your language. Write your name on it and write a little arrow on it. And what we're going to do, we're going to work without a question. So you're just going to explore a little bit. So it's not based on a question. It's exploring a little bit. And we're going to work, well, actually, what I'm going to say, you're going to work with three elements: you, your client, and business constellations. But you might also want to do the higher purpose of your company. Just whatever you want, or you can do both, but then it takes a little bit too long. So you write one piece of paper with me, one with your client, and one with business constellations or the higher purpose of your company. And then you put these pieces of paper on the floor, and not like I, this is just an example, but sense, start with one piece of paper and put it on the floor somewhere as if it was a person. So it has a direction, it faces some direction, and also give it the space it needs as if it were a person. And also treat it like it were a person. So don't throw it around. You're going to step on it, but don't throw it around. So start with you, and then either with the business constellations or your client. And intuitively, or think about it. There's no problem with thinking about it. So just think, oh, he's close or he's far away, and place it there. And then what you do, you step on me. So you step on the piece of paper with your name on it. And here you start sensing. And sensing is more than feeling. It's feeling, but also knowing. It's also about relationship. How do you relate to the other two elements, or maybe three if you put another one? What is happening in your body? So it's more like physical sensations. So it's, people like to say feeling, but I like the word sensing. What do you sense here? And how do you relate to the other elements? And you might also already feel a movement that you say, oh, I want to move forwards or backwards, or not from the others, but the movement for yourself. So make that movement if you like it. So you're not going to move around the other pieces of paper, but only the one you step on. And you can do this in your own pace. So whenever you, but now for now, I would like to, finish it up in like 5 minutes. So, or 10 maybe. So then step on your client. And now you can sense here, how does your client feel? What does your client feel at this specific spot? Physically, mentally, emotionally. And how does your client relate to business constellations and to you? And it's just information. So again, no judgment, just information. And you might feel a movement. You might say, oh, I want to move back, forward, left, or right. Or maybe you want to go to the other side of the room. It's all okay. Just follow that movement. Or you might sense that you want to move the other pieces, but that's just information. You're not going to do it, but well, imagine somebody saying, oh, I would like this person to be farther away and the business constellation to be closer. And then again, you step off the piece of paper. I didn't say that, but you really step off. And by stepping off, you also let go of the energy. So you might want to turn a little bit around. Maybe even stamp your feet. And then you step on the business constellations piece of paper, or the higher purpose of your company, depending on what you wrote on it. And it's interesting. Now you're connected to some abstract element. So what does this element, this business constellations, what does it sense at this spot? Physically, emotionally, mentally? How does it relate to your client? How does it relate to you? It's also interesting to look from the business constellation to yourself, to the piece of paper where it says you. And maybe this one also wants to move too. So if you feel a movement, if you sense like, oh, my feet want to move, or sometimes you see a spot, you say, oh, I want to be in that spot. Then you move over to that spot. But sometimes it's just, oh, I want to move, but I don't know where to. Then you start moving until you say, oh, this is a better spot. And again, you step off this piece of paper. You shake a little bit, stamp your feet. And you step onto the piece of paper yourself again. And what is interesting now is to sense what happened if the people have moved, the elements have moved, or they have said something, or you thought something, but just imagine that was people saying that to you. How do you react to that? What does it do to you when you hear that, or when you know that they want to move or did move? Or and breathe in, breathe out. Sometimes it might be a little confronting, because that's the risk of doing constellations, that nothing is revealed anymore. I wrote an article that 5 reasons why not to use constellations. And one was because it reveals everything. And maybe you want to make a last movement with your own piece of paper. And just so you say, okay, well, knowing this or sensing this, I want to move left, right, front, whatever. And know that you can do this later on. You can step on the other pieces of paper again and you can move around. And this is also exploring for you, how do I relate to constellations? Is it something that I want to do or not? How does my client react to constellations? And if you want to use constellations, you could also put a piece of paper, the promotion of constellations. And then you can step on that piece of paper and see, okay, so what is this about? You might even get information. Sometimes you even get an image. Oh, I need to write a website. Or maybe it's like, oh, no, I just need to be clear about what the solution is for what constellations bring. So that's more like a marketing constellation. So you can add elements yourself. And some people say, well, you're playing with energy and don't do this. And well, for me, there's a few rules. And one is that your intention is genuine. And that you really said, okay, this is what I want to know. It's not like I want to know what my client knows so I can win something. Or no, it's a genuine reason why you do this. And then it's also, that you work with the piece of paper as if they were people. And well, that you finish it. So finish is like, I would always suggest to end at your own piece of paper, and well, you might even thank the others, and then you take the piece of paper, you say thank you, thank you, thank you, and you maybe shake them a little bit and put them away so that the energy is gone from the piece of paper. And other than that, some people say you need all kinds of rituals and you shouldn't do it without any education, but I know that people do it very well without any education. So it's also using your own intuition and following your own intuition. Okay, I would like to explain a little bit about the training I'm giving. Because if you say, I want to learn more about using business constellation, then there's this 5-day training. I will be giving it in Bucharest and in Budapest. Let me see, I'll also give a link to the training. So below you will see more information about the training and also a link to the website, so you can go there. So you'll learn the basic stance as a facilitator. You will learn more about how to set it up, do the interventions, and you're going to learn it in groups and one-on-one and really practical. We're going to really work practically, and I will adjust it to your wishes. So if you say I want to use it in a large groups, we're going to find out how to practice in large groups. If you say I want to do it one-on-one, where you're going to work more one-on-one. And well, all the times I've given this training many times, and it turns out that, well, the group creates a perfect training together. And yeah, you will learn the intuitive approach. I'm not going to work really well with a lot with knowledge and with theories. There are a few books you can read that with a lot of theory, but you're going to practice and work and you know, learn on the job and use your intuition. So we also will focus on how to improve your intuition and how your intuition works. Well, I have two dates planned, one in Bucharest, Romania, 15th until the 19th. And I'm very happy about that because there are two people there, Christina and Oana. Christina is here. And I'm they're so excited and they're really helping me. And actually, they're organizing everything there. You might, if you want more information, you can go on the link below. But this is the real link that they have set up for me, the businessconstellations.org. And there you will find everything about that training in Bucharest. And then in November, I'll come to Budapest. And well, the link below also leads you to Budapest training. And I'll also give trainings in the Netherlands. So if you're interested in the Netherlands, but then they're in Dutch and these trainings are in English. So yeah, that's, if you have questions about this, let me know. If you say I wanna have a Skype call first to get to know you a little bit more, just send me an email. Let's stay connected. These are my contact information. And what I wanted to say, I'm gonna leave for the vacation, so I will be back around the 20th of August. So between now and the end of August, I might not react to your emails. That's if you are interested in Bucharest, you should go to this one, businessconstellations.org, and contact Christina or Oana. Okay, so there is a question. Did I ever do a constellation over Skype? Actually, yes, I did. And it was very interesting. I had the other person, my coachee, I had her stand on a piece of paper and report to me what she sends there. And it was amazing what happened. So yes, you can easily do it over Skype. Are there any other questions? I also put a link to my three business intuition tools. If you haven't gotten them yet, please sign up for them. And you will also be informed about activities I do, but also about blogs and vlogs I make. So a lot about intuition and business, constellations, personal development, all kinds of stuff like that. Well, if there are any questions, I'll be online in a few more minutes, so please let me know. If there are questions and you're watching this in the replay, please send me an email and I will answer them. And well, feel free to do the training. There's an interesting exercise you can do. If you go to the website, there's, I think, a link to, well, how do I know if I need to do this training? And it's also a constellation you can do to make choices. So it's not only interesting for this training, but also for other choices you have to make. And it gives you information if you should do this training now or maybe later or somewhere else. So, and I always like people to do that because then the people that will sign up are people that are really connected and intuitively drawn to my training. And then it works perfectly. So I'm happy to see you in Bucharest or in Budapest or maybe in the Netherlands or in another webinar. So feel free to do whatever you want. I wish you a very happy night. I think for most people that are watching, it's night. And well, we'll stay connected. Bye-bye. Oh, there's this question. Oh, The question is, do you ask people to give you feedback after a period of time? Well, actually, I forget that. But sometimes I get feedback and it's amazing what happens. And sometimes it's very subtle and people don't even notice it, because that's also interesting. After a constellation, sometimes your life changes, but it feels so normal and as if never, ever, if it had been like that all the time. So you might not even notice the change. But then when I ask, is it different than 2 months ago? And it's, oh yeah, it's completely different now you ask. So it's interesting, yeah. Do you do one constellation or more for one problem? It's also a good question. There are people that say that you can do only one constellation per year. Well, I've done more than that. But if you do like for one problem and you do five constellations from the same point of view with the same people, well, you get the same information. Sometimes what I do is that I first do a constellation one-on-one with the manager to find out, so what is happening here and what are the issues. And then we do a constellation with the team, where the team members represent themselves. And yeah, that's something what I do. So, or you take first step with a constellation, then you do some other methods to get more information, and then you do a constellation again to see, okay, if we want to do this marketing action, or if we do this or that, what would happen? Do you have any articles, tips, tricks on how to convince a managing director to implement constellation in the business? Yeah, don't convince anybody. Because if they don't want to, they don't want to. So what you can do is tell about it, share your experience. And sometimes I like to tease people a little bit. So do you dare to do something different? Do you dare to see a real problem, real cause of the problem? But if you really start, oh, I want to convince you, you need to do it. No, it will not work. So always also look inside what is happening inside you. Why do you want to convince this person? And if you can be really clear and clean about this, then you can explain it. And then if they say, well, we don't want to do it, then that's okay. Because there's always a right time and a right place for things. So that's, again, following the flow of life and not trying to control anything. Yeah, people forget about the effects. That's what Titan said. Yeah. And that's what I also like about it, is that it's so natural. It's not something that you need to learn and you need to, okay, now I need to do a different behavior and I need to practice a lot. No, people change, but it's so natural that they don't know that they have changed. So wonderful. Thank you for the questions. It's interesting. I always like it. And if you sign out, I have a little evaluation form. So if you can sign that, fill that out for me. Thank you. And then, well, now I'm leaving and I'll see you later.